Good evening, and I won't be making a speech. I'll be brief. But on behalf of the Center for Latin American Studies, I'd like to welcome all of you here to the 68th Annual Conference, Jews in the Americas. And it's pretty remarkable to think that our center has been organizing conferences like these every year for the past 68 years. This year's conference is jointly organized and with and supported by the Ezer Ray Price Library of Judaica, as well as the Alexander Grass Chair in Jewish Studies here at UF. We also receive very generous support through the U.S. Department of Education's National Resource Centers Program, the National Endowment for Humanities, the Bacardi Family Eminent Scholar Endowment, and the Kimberly Green Latin American and Caribbean Center at Florida International University. In particular, I want to thank the hard work of our organizing, conference organizing committee, and which Rebecca already mentioned most of their names, but it included Rebecca Jefferson, as well as Lenny Ureña, Mitch Hart, Nina Caputo, Catalin Rack, and Paul Loesch. And I'd also like to especially thank our conference coordinator, Maggie Martinez, for all of her hard work and especially patience in dealing with all the complicated logistics for this conference. I'd also like to thank Patricia Alba and the rest of the staff at the center, as well as the staff here at the Latin American Caribbean Collection, as well as the Judaica Collection, and the many graduate students from our MA program in Latin American Studies. And a special thanks to Wilson Tremura, I don't believe he's here tonight, but for all his work in organizing the workshop on Friday, as well as the musical performance, which we will have tomorrow evening. As you know, this year's conference brings together the fields of Latin American studies and Jewish studies, drawing from multidisciplinary as well as transnational perspectives to explore the various dimensions of the Jewish experience in the Americas from the 16th century up until today. And to help us in this exploration, we're fortunate to have been able to gather over 20 scholars from Latin America, from North America, Germany, and Israel to help us in this exploration, as well as the keynoters such as Tamar Herzog, who will be speaking tonight, and Dana Rabin, who will be speaking tomorrow at lunch. In addition, following the keynote speech tonight, I invite all of you to join in guided tours this evening of the Price Library's Judaica Suite, which is on the second floor of the library. And also, of course, tomorrow evening to enjoy the Bacardi Scholar Concert Encuentro by Silvio Chulea and his Maharaja Flamenco Trio, who will be playing tomorrow during dinner at the historic Thomas Center downtown. And finally, I'd like to thank the UF Libraries and especially the Latin American Caribbean Collection for allowing us to use this space for tonight. It's a beautiful venue to be able to kick off our conference. And now I'd like to turn it over to Professor Emerita, Dr. Ida Altman, who will be introducing our keynote speaker for this evening. Thank you.
Well, I don't really feel like I belong here, but I'm back. So it's a great honor to me to introduce Tamar Herzog, whom I met many, many years ago and also haven't seen for many years, so it's great to have her here. She's a distinguished scholar of the early modern Spanish Empire and currently is the Monroe Gutman Professor of Latin American Affairs at Harvard University. She is also an affiliated faculty member at the law school there. Previously, she taught at Stanford University, University of Chicago, and La Universidad Autónoma de Madrid. She holds a law degree and she earned her PhD at the École des Études in Paris. She has taught at the European University Institute in Florence, Italy, and was a Guggenheim Fellow. Tamar Herzog has published numerous books and articles on early modern Iberian, European, and Spanish American history. She received the James A. Raleigh Prize in Atlantic History from the American Historical Association for her book, Frontiers of Possession, Spain and Portugal in Europe and the Americas. Tamar's influential book, Defining Nations, which was published in 2003, is of considerable relevance to the themes of this conference, so I just want to talk about this just briefly. For this project, she conducted her research in a number of archives in Spain and Spanish America. As I'm sure many of you know, doing research on the early modern period often means searching for and using sources that can be fragmentary and scarce. In some ways, the nature as well as the survival of archival records and other sources shape the results of scholarly inquiry. But just as important as the available records are the questions that one brings to bear. The central one that Tomer Herzog addresses in this landmark book seems simple enough. How did early modern Iberian societies determine who belonged and who did not? The answers are to be found at the complex intersection of law, social practice, cultural understandings, and political construction. Notably, both the question and the answers that she provides not only illuminate our understanding of the early modern Spanish Empire, but also resonate with the challenges that have faced societies and nation states down to the present day. Who belongs? Who does not? Who can be integrated? And how are those determinations made? In defining nations, Tomer Herzog emphasizes the importance of local society within the Spanish Empire as the site where determinations of inclusion or exclusion were made. Clearly, this finding is not just an artifact of a long ago history. Today, in the United States, we see that local and national understandings of what the southern border with Mexico means differ greatly. Some communities today identify themselves as sanctuary cities for immigrants, notwithstanding that this status puts them at variance with state and federal law and mandates. The continuing relevance of Dr. Herzog's work and conclusions will make her talk a thought-provoking starting point for the next 2 days of this conference. So I want to congratulate and thank the conference organizers for all the hard work that they've done to put this together. And I join them in extending a very warm welcome to Tomer Herzog.
Good evening. Thank you for this invitation. When Professor Caputo invited me, I said, but I don't work on Jews. And she said, it's okay. Let's make about something else. So I did make some concession, and there will be some of them among the pages. But what I was trying to do for this talk is actually try to insert them in a larger debate and think about how categories employed towards Jews actually were also employed for other social sectors, and what do they tell us also about the Jewish experience. So between 1609 and 1614, some 300,000 individuals of Muslim descent were ordered to leave the Iberian Peninsula. Historians who have studied these measures remarked that these orders were issued against persons who were at least nominally Christian. They explained that from as early as 1500, Muslims living on Iberian soil were encouraged and then forced to convert, first by mass conversions and then by decrees that in 1502 and 1526 gave them the choice between conversion and exile. As a result, in the early 17th century, when these individuals of Muslim descent were ordered into exile, all of them were by definition Christians. The question why Christians of Muslim descent, which is how I often call it in this talk, were expelled from Spain has generated a huge bibliography. Historians argue that although most Muslims chose conversion over exile, in the aftermath of this decision, they hardly modified their way of being. Separate and distinct from all other Spaniards, they remained in the same communities, obeyed with the same authorities, and persisted in the use of Arabic, their old dress code, and following the same diet. Also persisting were intellectual and commercial ties with Muslim authorities and individuals across the seas. Many observers, both past observers and present-day historians, thus conclude that converts of Muslim origin had their bodies in Iberia but their soul in Dar es Salaam, that is in lands where Islam dominated. According to this narrative, this continuity despite conversion was initially tolerated. However, gradually, the Christian authorities began censoring this persistence, among other things, because they considered it an indication of either insincere or incomplete conversion. Thereafter, the Christian authorities began banning certain customs as well as devising projects targeting the redistribution of converso Muslims across Spain with the aim of ensuring both the breakup of existing communities as well as the insertion of individuals and families into new Christian-dominated enclaves. Eventually, concluding that most former Muslims were permanent and dangerous religious and cultural renegades, in the early 17th century, the Spanish king decreed the expulsion. The decision favoring expulsion was nevertheless accompanied by constant debates as to whether certain individuals could or should be spared. Children, for example, or persons who already lived in Christian communities, severe ties with all other former Muslims, were married to Christians, or had manifested in other ways their sincere Christian belief. In the end, however, the sincerity of conversion was deemed mostly irrelevant, as eventually almost all former Muslims were already into exile. At this stage, you would probably ask, why speak about conversos of Muslim descent in a conference based on the Jewish experience in the Americas? Well, because historians have long remarked both the similarities and differences between the way Jews and Muslims were treated in early modern Spain and its overseas domains. As is well known, attempts to convert Jews were frequent in late medieval Spain, where on many occasions, like the Muslims, Jews were baptized in ceremonies of mass conversion. Although the religious transformation might have been superficial, as happened with Muslims, it bore important legal consequences. As Christian, these former Jews were subjected to Christian authorities in both civil and religious matters. This meant that as Christians, they were under the jurisdiction of municipal magistrates in their places of residence, and that as Christian, they were under tutelage of the local church and most feared the local Inquisition. The coexistence side by side of Jews and Christians ended, as we know, in 1492, when the royal authorities gave Jews an option similar to the one they would eventually give Muslims a few years later, either to convert or to go into exile. Those who converted were both integrated and rejected, as would happen with conversos of Muslim origin. Contemporaries constantly question whether the conversion of the Jews who preferred to remain in Iberia was sincere and whether it was complete. If conversos of both Jewish and Muslim descent had a somewhat similar experience in the 15th and 16th century, by the early 17th century it became evident that this would no longer be the case. While Christians who descended of Jews, which is another way to think about conversos, even if they were on occasion persecuted or discriminated against, could remain in Iberia, those who descended of Muslims were ordered into exile. The question historians have asked ever since is why? Why allow conversos of Jewish religion to remain and expel all those of Muslim descent? This question operated not only in peninsular Iberia, but also on the other side of the ocean. Theoretically, conversos belonging to both groups, both Muslims and Jews, were barred from immigrating to the New World. According to decrees dated in 1501 and repeated in 1518 and 1530, later integrated in the most important compilation of royal decisions, the Recopilación de Indias of 1681, no one newly converted to Catholicism of Muslim or Jewish descent, nor their sons, could immigrate to the Americas without obtaining a special license. To assure that this would not happen, the authorities required candidates for immigration to present the judicial information certifying, among other things, that they were not of these prohibited types. Though similar orders were granted regarding new Christians of both Jewish and Muslim descent, in the New World, it was mainly the potential presence of those originating in Jews that caused most preoccupation. Historians still debate how many had crossed the Atlantic, and I know some of you will talk about it tomorrow. But they tend to agree that anxiety regarding who they were and whether their conversion was truthful exploded during the Union of the Crowns of Castile and Portugal. 1580 to 1640. The reason being that in contemporary appreciation, being a Portuguese and having a Jewish descent were one and the same thing. So for contemporaries, all Portuguese were new Christians and all new Christians were Portuguese. The identification, and this is especially strong in Spanish America, of practically all the Portuguese as new converts, was linked to the belief that many Spanish Jews had fled to Portugal in the late medieval period, thus considerably augmenting the size and importance of the Portuguese Jewish community. According to popular view, the forced conversion of the Portuguese Jews in 1497 has been less successful than that of Spanish Jews, paradoxically, because Portuguese Jews were not given the option of exile, but instead were all forced to convert. The absence of inquisitorial persecution in Portugal until 1536, when the first inquisitorial court was established, further enhanced these conclusions, which now pointed both to the prevalence of former Jews in Portugal, as well as to the likelihood, because of the lack of persecution, of widespread persistence of Jewish beliefs. The fact that many Portuguese who immigrated to the Americas during the Union of the Crowns were merchants only intensified this association between the Portuguese and converts of Jewish descent, because according to contemporary conviction, Jews and former Jews, now turned Christian, were mostly merchants, and merchants were mostly Jews. The association between Portuguese and conversos of Jewish origin was so immediate and so strong in Spanish America that most intellectuals never really questioned it. It resulted in a constant suspicion against all Portuguese, suspicion that greatly intensified in periods of heightened political tensions between Spain and Portugal. These political tensions resulted in the persecution of the Portuguese in Spanish America, now accused not only of political infidelity, but also of secretly practicing their Judaism. Particularly famous in this regard were the campaigns unleashed by the Inquisition against such individuals in major Spanish American centers and port towns such as Mexico City, Lima, or Cartagena in the 1630s and 1640s, coinciding with the uprising and the independence of Portugal. Though the presence in Spanish America of individuals who should not have crossed the Atlantic preoccupied the authorities, most efforts were invested not in expelling the new converts of Jewish descent, but in questioning their faith and their political allegiance. It was almost as if Jewish descent, at least in many cases, was commonly known or assumed fact. The only question being whether it indicated or not to some political, social, or religious danger. Yet, while former Jews had to demonstrate their loyalty, most individuals accused in Spanish America of Muslim descent, which were actually equally banned from the jurisdiction, instead then tended to deny their origins. Rather than insisting on their correct religious belief, as most Christians of Jewish descent or suspected of having Jewish descent did, to the suspicion that they were new converts, most conversos of Muslim descent mostly replied that they were not. If this was true, that is, if in both Spain and Spanish America, converts of Jewish descent had to mainly prove the sincerity of their conversion, while those of Muslim descent had to renegade their origin or else to leave, how can we account for these differences? I would like to leave this question hanging for a moment and move instead to inquire on the meaning of the newness of which members of both groups were accused. Their status as recent converts or their categorization, very common as new Christians, is often taken for granted as if it reflected a factual situation. But I would like to ask, what did newness mean in the early modern Spanish context? And what, on the contrary, enabled others to enjoy the status of oldness? So let me turn to old and new in the Hispanic world. The preference of old versus new was perhaps natural in a society which respected established authorities and customs and suspected everything that could not be classified as well established. Nonetheless, the categorization of some Christians as old and others as new was also tied to debates inside the church, debates that sought to establish distinction between different types of Christians. These distinctions already originated in the New Testament, where it was asserted that adults, mainly defined as those 14 years of was age or older, who converted to Christianity were different from all other Christians because rather than more Christians, they were neophytes, were the terms that in Greek means newly planted. Because they converted as adults rather than were born into Christianity or converted as children, neophytes were to be subjected to greater control and stringent supervision and were to be discriminated against, for example, by their exclusion from priesthood. While marginalized in some ways, in theory at least, neophytes also merited greater protection. Considered young in the faith, they would be treated as children, their conversion being considered a rebirth and their education eliciting constant care and instruction. According to Thomas Aquinas of the 13th century, this differential treatment made sense not only because converts should be shielded until they completed their transition to Christendom, but also because this discrimination was a means to protect the church and the sacrament of baptism, ensuring that it would not be taken falsely or without sufficient belief. New adult converts should be granted immediate entry to the community, so did Aquinas argue, only in very exceptional cases in which there was no doubt that they were perfectly prepared for it, only facing death. From a juridical point of view, and I'm a legal historian, the problem I have with all this literature is that measures against neophytes rarely defined when the new converted would cease being considered thus. Different authors suggested different solutions. I was really kind of not to try to understand when do you stop being a neophyte and become a good Christian. Some proposed that a year-long testing period should be sufficient. Others requested a longer probation, and actually talk about this probation period. Although debates persisted from the late antiquity to modernity, by the late Middle Ages, the newness of neophytes could persist for several decades and could even be transmitted to children and grandchildren. It was also during this period that canonists began describing conversion not as a one-step experience, but as a lifelong journey, as a work in progress. According to this view, the initial rite of entry and recognition, that is baptism, was but the mere beginning of a much longer and complex process. Thereafter, constant proofs would be required from converts attesting that the transition from non-Christian to Christian was indeed complete. Completeness, however, and this is again canon lawyers speaking about it, depended on who, when, and where. It was generally agreed that different individuals and different contexts merited a differential treatment because each displayed a distinct set of circumstances, including a distinct aptitude for change. Satisfaction that completeness had been achieved, however, also depended on the question whether at stake was discrimination. Usually negative things, discrimination require more stringent interpretation or benefits that usually allows for a broader, more generous, more flexible interpretation. Most medieval canonists ended up adopting 60 years or the passing of three generations as the maximum length of time providing a satisfactory guarantee for a real change. Nonetheless, in the 15th and 16th centuries, some authors suggested that in certain cases, suspicion could last forever. By the end of this process, newness could indicate to chronology, to the passage of time, but it could also reference essential characteristic that allegedly bars certain people from ever being truly converted. This understanding was applied to converts of both Jewish and Muslim descent. In the late medieval and early modern, Spain, their newness, it was argued, would last forever. They were to remain a Christian no matter how long they or their ancestors, how long ago they or their ancestors had converted. Debate, however, persisted. The wish to constitute a standing difference between old and new, most particularly in case of converts of Jewish and Muslim descent, won both admiration and criticism, both followers and opponents. The popes and the jurists were just as conflicted and perplexed as to what should be done. In 1573, for example, the Pope declared that converts descending of Muslim Jews and condemned heretics could not become priests until the fourth generation. But theologians and jurists who interpreted these orders asked whether the decree was intended to exclude all descendants of Jews and Muslims or only those who have guilty of heresy? Responding to such inquiries, some canon law experts explained that under normal circumstances, no distinction should be instituted between old and new Christians. However, they justify making such distinction in the case of Jews and Muslims who had converted under duress or without expressing a true free will. While these should be permanent neophytes, other converts from Judaism and Islam should not. Several authors also suggested that if in theory the rights and duties of Christians should be the same regardless of the day in which they converted, this rule could be suspended on occasion. True, conversion should bestow privileges on converts, but at stake would be the question which privileges, when, and how many. Hesitations regarding the status of neophyte were thus tied not only to distrust, but also to debates as to who could change and how fast. In this scenario, blood and inheritance could explain a particular capacity to change or justify its absence. But it was also under these circumstances that Jewish and Muslim bodies were portrayed as incapable of true change. Blood and inheritance, however, also played other roles in these juridical debates. According to canon law jurists, baptism was a sacrament that conferred belonging. In the case of individuals of Christian descent, however, what it actually did is recognize as members children who were already both de facto and de jure under the jurisdiction of the church. Such was not the case with the baptism of each individual who did not descend of Christian parents. In the case, the ties established through baptism were completely new, and thus they could carry a distinct set of rights and obligations. The question whether newness in faith was transitory or whether it would stigmatize a certain group permanently was also raised during the conquest of the Americas and as a result of the move to Christianize Native Americans. While all agreed that Native Americans should be treated as neophytes in the initial stages of the conquest, questions were asked whether they should be considered thus perpetually, leading, for example, to their enduring exclusion from priesthood. Some interlocutors suggested that such would be the case. In 1555, for example, the Church Council meeting in Mexico legislated to that effect, coining the rule that no person descending of parents or grandparents burned at the stake or reconciled with the church of Muslim descent, mestizo, Indians, or mulattoes, could become priests. Similar provisions were also included in the canons of the Second Council of Lima, meeting at the second half of the 16th century. According to these canons, new converts should not be ordained. Although the language of the canon was general, historians affirmed that it was directed at including Indians because by that stage and in this context, Indians and neophytes were terms that most contemporaries used as slaves. Also by that stage, at least some interlocutors believed that the discrimination of natives was justified not only by the date of their conversion, but also by reference to their so-called origins. According to this claim, exclusion from priesthood was to ensure that only individuals whom the faithful respect and esteem would become priests. Because of these convictions, the easiest way for natives to ascend to priesthood was not by pressing a recognition that natives were old Christians and no longer neophyte, but by making sure that they were no longer classified as Indian. Such was the case, apparently, in large extensions of the America, where the number of individuals classified as natives gradually diminished during the 16th, 17th century, not only, not necessarily, because of indigenous mortality at this stage, but instead because many individuals fled this category if and when they could. So let me turn now to new and old in the civic sphere, not in the religious sphere. While discussion regarding old and new frequently focused on religious conversion, this was not the only field in which these distinctions operated. Take, for example, the case of the Roma, also known as Gypsies, and their treatment in Spain and Spanish America. In the 16th, 17th, and 18th century, repeating royal orders instructed the Roma to change their way of life, admonishing them that unless they did, they would be persecuted, incarcerated, or even sentenced to death. The orders prohibited the Roma from residing in separate neighborhoods, using special clothing, or speaking their distinct language. The expulsion of the Roma from Spain was decreed in 1695, of which only Roma residing permanently in large municipalities and occupying agricultural activities would be exempt. The immigration of the Roma to Spanish America was also prohibited. The decree censoring and potentially punishing the Roma identified them as gypsies. This is the way the Spaniards call them. Yet, those who sought protection against these very harsh measures used a completely different terminology. So I was looking at the way people discussed whether they should be included or not in the expulsion decrees because they were identified as gypsies as well. These people suggested that in Spain and Spanish America, they were old and new Castilians. So they didn't speak about gypsies, they spoke about old and new Castilians. Castellanos viejos and Castellanos nuevos. Well, the first, old Castellanos, were ordinary Spaniards, whatever this means, who should not be punished, nor banned. The second were gypsies, that is, new Castilians, who merited the unforgiving treatment that the decrees ordered. None of the speakers who invoked these categories, old and new Castilians, defined newness and distinguished it unambiguously from oldness. Nonetheless, in the ensuing discussions, so I was reading what people said, what they responded, and how it was structured, this discussion clarified that its stake was never chronology. The distinction between one type, new Castilians, also called gypsies, and another, old Castilians, also called Spaniards, was not linked to the length of residence in Spain. Instead, it demarcated a status that allegedly depended on behavior. According to this discussion, while old Castilians behaved well, new Castilians, that is, gypsies, did not. They separated themselves from the bulk of Spaniards and they committed mischief in the form of antisocial inherited behavior. There were many other ways during the early modern period in which new and old were meaningful in both Spain and Spanish America. Besides justifying the discrimination of the Roma, these adjectives were also employed to create and justify a permanent distinction between native and naturalized foreigners. Or said differently, according to the terms of the period, between Españoles antiguos and Españoles nuevos. So now we have Castellanos nuevos, Castellanos antiguos. I found Españoles nuevos, Españoles nuevos, or antiguos. This distinction between Españoles antiguos and Españoles nuevos was central to 18th century debates regarding the naturalization of Catholic foreigners of European descent. So here we have a discussion with people who are religiously okay, you're Catholic, and European, so it's not a racial question. These debates regarding the naturalization of Catholic Europeans, but foreign, pitted locals against foreigners who had immigrated to Spain and Spanish America and who had requested to benefit from the privileges of Spanish natives, for example, the right to hold public office for ecclesiastical benefit, or the right to immigrate and trade in the world. Naturalized individuals, local argued, could never be equal in rights to the real and original natives, verdaderos y originales naturales, because they were new rather than old Spaniards. Old Spaniards should be preferred to new Spaniards because their Spanishness was more perfect and more complete. They descended from Spanish families who had lived in Spain and were in the habit of obeying the king for hundreds of years. Their love for the community was more radical and they were therefore more trustworthy. By the late 18th century, the language of old and new also permeated debates regarding the access of free Africans to the privileges of Spaniards. While individuals of African descent, mainly living in Spanish America, argued that they were worthy of the privileges of natives, Spaniards, those who opposed them stressed their profound and enduring foreignness. They suggested that even if Afro-Spaniards were born in the territory of parents also born there, they could not be trusted because they were new rather than old whites. So now we found in the sources, nuevos y viejos blancos. Far from looking to Spain, at the center of their interest, those of African descent kept their eyes on the dark people of Africa, which is where they come from, to patronize them and raise them against the Spaniards, the orphans, so they say, of all their grievances. Those intellectuals who wished to bar Spaniards of African descent from achieving fuller integration asked, was it sensible to pretend that the new whites were more loyal to Spain than the old whites? That's the terms they use in the discussion. Could those of African descent ever wish the well-being of the country as those who truly originated from it? If such was not the case, why should they qualify to the benefits reserved to old whites? In these debates, obviously, whiteness was equal to Spanishness and blackness to foreignness. But as some historians have already demonstrated, in that particular setting, whiteness was an achievable status, not a permanent trait. Individuals of African descent who were admitted to the militia, the church, and the local and rural bureaucracy, which are all benefits reserved to natives, that is, to Spaniards, for example, could thereafter think of themselves as both Spaniards and as white of the land, as it's a term they use, blancos de la tierra. Okay, so all the new, the larger European debates around opening, trying to open it even further. So historians who have studied these discussions, all the new Castilian, all the new Spanish, all the new whites, all the new converts, tended to classify them as xenophobic. That's how that should be put. They suggested that Spaniards reacted violently to the presence of group they considered external, and they credited Spain with inventing racism. Yet the question when outsiders become insiders. So I'm going back to what Ida, I think, alluded to. And what could faithfully account for this transformation from outsider to insider was a much larger inquiry that preoccupied many Europeans at the time, today, I think. If religious conversion could lead to the formation of neophytes, and if it justified distinction between old and new Christians across Europe, discussion regarding civic conversion was were just as important. Just as prominent. They too indicated the social, political, and juridical difficulty in defining that moment in which a transition from outsider to insider had been completed. A moment that theoretically would justify, perhaps even compel, communities to give those who had been outsiders the treatment of insiders. Jurisprudence from 14th century Italian city-states, so the Juris of Jus Comune, speaks to some of this issue. Italian city-states admitted newcomers to citizenship, yet many instituted a discriminatory regime that generated permanent distinction between true and original citizens, old citizens, and newly adopted ones, new citizens. Asked to give his opinion regarding these rules, in the 14th century, Bartolus de Sassofrato, perhaps the most prominent contemporary jurist, concluded that this distinction between true and naturalized citizens, old citizens and new citizens, made absolutely no sense. Cities, he stated, could legitimately institute several types of citizenship, each with a different regime of rights and duties. What was utterly illogical, however, is to argue that while some citizens were true and natural, others were not. That while some citizens were old, others were new. Citizenship, he wrote, was instituted by human conventions and was introduced by civil, not natural law. As a result, all citizens were equally artificial and equally new. None was more new or more artificial than the other. Following suit, Baldus de Ubaldis, his students, and a very venerable jurist himself, so this is now at the end of the 14th century, concluded that the deliberate decision by a newcomer to change his place of domicile could take precedence over the automatic allegiance the individual was said to have to their community of birth. Baldus also rejected the claim that the natural inclination towards the community of origin was by definition stronger than any ties a newcomer could have with the community of reception. By rendering this judgment, Baldus attempted to protect merchants and commerce. Merchants were often a very noble kind. But he also wished, and we know it from his writing, to shield new citizens against attacks by what he called nativists. Those people who portrayed new members as permanent and enduring outsiders and claimed they merited better treatment. If the transition from old to new was a complicated affair, and if it unleashed a battle, both religious and civic, across Europe, between those wishing for integration and those wanting to bar it, this general debate also had its particularities in early modern Spain and Spanish America. So let me turn back to the beginning and ask, who were these Muslims, new Christians, whose expulsion was decreed? How did contemporaries distinguish between them and old Spaniards or old converts? and converts. The early 17th century decrees that ordered the expulsion of converts of Muslim descent never answered these questions. That is, they did not define who Christian of Muslim descent were, or how they could be distinguished from other people Spaniards. Historians explain that even after their conversion, who these individuals were was often evidence. Indeed, despite the conversion, former Muslims, now turned Christians, could still be identified by cultural traits, such as the use of Arabic or the wearing of specific dress, and by social practices that had many of them remain in the same communities, restrict most of their activities there, as well as their marriage choices to other members of the group. These identifying features, culture, and sociability helped the authorities, so we are told, and the society at large to discern who descended of Muslim and thus who would be expelled. Yet, we also know that in practice, despite the order to expel all Christians of Muslim descent, not everybody was targeted. If initially those who could prove that they were well integrated could remain in Iberia, eventually only those who were so utterly incorporated into local society to the point that both they and those around them forgot, tended to forget their religion, could and in fact often remained. In other words, whatever the intention might have been, in the end, the decrees of expulsion could only be applied to those known as new Christians or behaving as new Christians. All others whose behavior was normative and whose ancestry was forgotten or pretended to be forgotten were necessarily left alone. This consideration led some historians to argue that the orders mandating expulsion could paradoxically be viewed as a final attempt to assimilate Spaniards of Muslim descent. Simply put, in the aftermath of these orders, no one looking like a Muslim, behaving like a Muslim, or having a known Muslim past could remain in Spain. In other words, the decrees sought to raise a memory of what had been and what existed. They instituted an imaginary watershed moment and enabled Spaniards to reimagine both who they and what Spain was, or who they were and what Spain was. Because in the post-expulsion period, de jure, even if not de facto, Spaniards of Muslim descent simply ceased to exist, became an extremist. Of course, this is a complicated claim to make, because detecting traces of silent assimilation, that is the presence of those who could remain in Spain because they no longer were identified as former Muslims, is much harder than finding indication for open resistance or persecution. Right? How do we study the integration and disappearance of groups? It's impossible. Yet clues for its importance and persistence exist in the historical record. For example, already a century before the expulsion, the number of conversos of Muslim descent mentioned in archival sources gradually diminished. They just disappear out of the records, metamorphosis or something, as if the memory of their presence was slowly disappearing. Paradoxically, it was precisely at this conjuncture that some social actors, preoccupied with this oblivion, sought to institute and ensure recollection. As the actual numbers of subjects categorized by their environments, categorizing themselves as former Muslims, was diminishing, most particularly in Castile, where integration seemed to have been particularly successful, their once upon a time existence, these individuals argued, had to be remembered. The instrument they selected to perform this task was the Limpia Thursday. It instituted a new distinction between those whose blood was allegedly pure because they were all Christians, and those whose blood was contaminated because they were new Christians. The purity of blood decrees thus sought to ensure recollection, I think precisely because of the fear, perhaps the reality, of it fading away. Ironically, we now know that many of the converts who were stigmatized in the 16th and 17th century by their Muslim descent were in reality of Jewish or Christian descent. So we have investigation on that too. Many among them were offsprings of peninsular families who were either forced or enticed to convert to Islam after the territory was conquered by Muslims in the 8th, 9th, 10th century. Others descended of captives who were equally pressed to convert to Islam. Many of these former Jews and Christians adopted Arabic as their language and even pretended to be of Arab descent. Yet despite attempts to pass as all Muslims, their status as converts and new Muslims was sufficiently well known that the last Muslim ruler of Granada, famous Boabdil, requested in the Treaty of Capitulation he signed with the Catholic kings in 1491, that despite their Jewish or Christian origin, these new Muslims would be allowed to maintain their new faith and their adhesion to Islam. If accusation of newness depended on memory, claims for antiquity were based on opinion. Discussion regarding all the new thus adopted as historically true the phantasmagorical convention that all communities, whether religious or secular, Muslim, Christian, or Jewish, had some members whose ancestors had always belonged and others whose ancestors did not. But of course, affirmation of authenticity and fantasies of purity depended on the absence or presence of information and on the willingness or unwillingness to ask hard questions. Just as important was what was remembered and what was forgotten, as those claiming the need for discrimination remember certain things but not others. They remembered, as an example I mentioned before, that some Spaniards descended of Jews or Muslims, but they forgot that many Muslims were of Jewish or Christian descent. They also did not ask who the other Spaniards descended from. While some interlocutors insisted on forgetting who they were, but on remembering who others had been, others adopted the contrary policy. In early modern Spain, there were also individuals who were willing to refute claims for exclusivity by invoking memory. Privileges, these people argued, could not be granted on the basis of antiquity in Spain, and I cite one of the people speaking, because no one can prove that he is a descendant of the companion of Tuval, who, because of the confusion of languages at Tower of Babel, came to live in Spain. Spain having been so flooded with innumerable nations that even the most genealogical person cannot boast an origin previous to the Goth, who came to Spain after many other nations did. Such people suggested that until now, no one had imagined or thought to form a genealogical tree that would declare the degree of antiquity in Spain just to obtain the privileges of native. At any rate, in a melting pot like Spain, it would be impossible to distinguish an original from another original member. Back to conversos of Jewish descent, the typical answer the literature gave for why they could remain in Spain, even if on occasion they were persecuted, while conversos of Muslim descent could not, was that while converso Jews did their best to draw as little attention to themselves as possible, those of Muslim descent refused to follow this road. Instead, they were obstinate in stressing their differences. So they were also holding to memory. Regardless of the question whether this was true, and many now consider it an inaccurate description, most historians nevertheless agree that in the long run, what most distinguished conversos of Jewish descent was not their supposed allegiance to Judaism, but their enduring attachment to their religion. Whether they were practicing Jews, Orthodox Christians, or go-betweens, even proto-atheists, Spaniards of Jewish origins formed the diaspora that was spread throughout Europe, Africa, Asia, and America. This diaspora was structured as a network of relative friends and business associates that coalesced around a common identity that was not really religious, but instead was grounded on the common Iberian past. While they continued to associate with one another, often despite religious differences, members of this network, who remained attached to Hispanic traditions, spoke Spanish, sang Spanish songs, and followed Spanish customs. This memory of having belonged and having been Spanish was constantly reenacted by the circulation of members who returned to the Iberian Peninsula and left it once again. Some moved by economic opportunity, family ties, affinity to Iberian culture, and ability to culturate the Jewish community elsewhere, ended up resettling permanently in Iberia. Although the numbers are difficult to establish, hundreds might have followed this road. Contacts between converso of Jewish origin in Spain were also enacted by the refusal to admit as members of Sephardic communities, Jews of non-Iberian origin, or the general prohibition of marrying outside the group. Thus, although recent scholarship insists that the initial reaction of exiles of both Jewish and Muslim descent might have not been radically different, as we have already assumed, now we have research that actually show us that some converts of Muslim descent returned to the Iberian Peninsula Others were identified as either Christian or Iberians in the territories where they found refuge, where they attempted to maintain what the host community imposed on them some degree of separation. And many former Spaniards of Muslim descent engaged in dogamous practices. Others reivindicated their Spanish past. So they did a lot of things that we associate with the Sephardic community. It is nevertheless clear that convents of Muslim origin did not form a dense international community the way its Spaniards of Jewish origin did, and they did not maintain a memory of difference beyond the first few generations. Paradoxically, fascination with the injuries of recollection, with the persistence of loyalty to Spain or the memory of Spain, and the existence of a Sephardic world that was Hispanic rather than necessarily Jewish, intrigued not only historians, not only Jews, but also Spanish legislators. Timidly, during the government of Primo de Rivera in the early 20th century, and more clearly with the return of democracy to Spain in the 1980s, these legislators, and now Portuguese legislators following them, gave special privileges to the descendants of Iberian Jews, but not Iberian Muslims. Distinguishing yet again between the treatment of former Spaniards of Jewish descent and former Spaniards of Muslim origin, these legislators established that those descending of Spanish Jews, regardless of the question whether they're Jewish, Christian, or atheist, should be allowed readmission to Spain in the form of an accelerated process of naturalization. At last, the new could become old.